So I'm going to do, this is the deep dive into Friend OS, where we are at right now. Our beta version is ready, planned to be ready in October, but there's still there's already a lot to show now, so I hope you guys won't be too disappointed. So I don't know how much you guys have seen, but I'm gonna assume you haven't seen anything. We basically started out for a client in a company we founded in Norway, which was doing web development and software integration between different systems. And so I got a job to integrate different Windows disks with a CRM system for an accounting firm. And I got this idea to make a desktop with disks on it, to give a familiar screen. But then I went to sleep one night, and I got this idea. What if I would do something else in addition to what I was doing? So I suddenly got this huge idea. I went to the office. I talked with my co-worker, Michael, and suddenly, you know, this was like a vortex pulling us in. So basically what we decided to do was to create an operating system that used the web technology as a graphical user interface, and then put the kernel written in C on either the same device, but since there were separate programs, you could put the server in the cloud or on the LAN or wherever you wanted. And as long as you had the IP address to it, you could connect to it and download the user interface. And so we started building the Friend OS. It has a really strong resemblance to the Amiga OS, and that's because this is basically the template. And so basically what we've done is that we've built an Amiga-like desktop environment that uses a custom-made server kernel. It's a mix between, the best way to describe it is, it's a mix between a web server and a kernel. And we're using this as an abstraction layer to make available all the resources on the host environment. So if it's running on Windows, it abstracts the resources available on Windows. If it's running on Linux, it abstracts the resources available on Linux. If it's running on both, one instance is running on Linux and one is running on Windows, you can put a that abstracts that abstracts both the systems at the same time, going through the access level. So if you imagine these servers set up, you have the one you're accessing through the IP address, and then that one can be accessing other nodes to make available those resources at that location. So that's the cluster. You have a cluster, and then you choose an access node, and that's how you get into the resources available there. The desktop environment itself has a lot of capabilities, so it's doing a lot of stuff on the client. This is not some type of secret thing that's streaming raster graphics. Everything in the graphical user interface is handled by JavaScript. And then the processing is happening at the server end. So what we have is we have a title bar, we have a dock, we have a window list, and we have the partitions. So what you can see here is that I have several partitions available. The system partition is a bit like the Amiga OS system partition. It has the settings of references, if you prefer that. And it has triggers, functions, I'm going to get a bit into that as well, it's a bit more down the line. The applications, which is basically an index of all the applications available to you. Plugins, everything is accessible through the system. This is like the ROM type of thing. You know, you can't write this file, screen only. Of course, you can, it will reflect the changes you do low level, but you can't destroy it. So, what we decided to do in Friend was to take the coolest features from our point of view on the Amiga OS and build something out of that. And for me, there are some features that are really amazing on the Amiga OS that no other OS could do. Number one, the file system and file structure. How the Amiga OS treated partitions was unique. On Windows, you have the C colon stuff, and there's still, you know, the ABC, and it never went beyond the ABC. On the Mac OS, after they killed their own operating system and started using BSD instead, they just put a skin over the Unix file structure. So it looks sweet on the desktop environment, but once you open the shell, it's something else. And you have all the other systems, which basically emulate the Windows or the MS-DOS implementation. You find all kinds of wild new OSs, and they have C colon and B colon and all that stuff, so they don't go past that. The Amiga OS had literal partition names. So you could name them something that would be more familiar to you. And you felt, you know, like in Linux, everything starts with a forward slash, and then it attaches to the root of the tree. This is a bit confusing because it's just one structure, even though it's many structures. So in this way, I think the Amiga OS was much better because it gave a more spatial perspective to the file system. So we followed that, and then we went further. We said, okay, you had the FFS, OFS, SFS, different file systems on the Amiga. It's doing the same thing. And then you had some experimental projects with making FTP file systems and different ones for the Amiga OS. But they never went as far as they could have gone. So what we did, we make everything into a file system. Because it's really easy to make virtual file systems for Friend OS. It's very easy. And this is how everything can become a file system in Friend OS. So here I have the Amiga 30 website. It's mount websites as doors. We call it doors because it's not quite disks. It's more in the BBS mode. This is not finished, so it might be a dumb idea. So let's call it disks. And so when you open a website as a disk, of course, it becomes directories and the index file. So I'm going to now go a bit further because you have so many things you can abstract of it as disks. In our twin company, we're making this type of Facebook social networking system. It is a bit like you have chat, you have booking, you have calendars, you have library, you can upload movies, you know, all that stuff. In Friend, it's a file system. So we like to do a little flip and say, that social network is how our disk looks like if it's viewed as a social network. We mount it, and it becomes something like this. And I actually have the chat program, which is running here. And so basically what you're seeing is the social system abstracted in an app running inside the Friend OS. So by using the APIs that are available in the tree root social networking system, I just built this chat function interfacing with that. It has also audio and video chat. So it becomes really easy to access all kinds of systems when they're all disks. Because when they're all disks, it's the same way to use every system. You go to the disk, double-click that, you go to the folder, you double-click that, you go to the file, you double-click that, and you get a form that does something different for each file format. This way, if you want to have update your website, you double-click the website disk that you connect, you double-click the content directory, you double-click the page, and you edit that, and you just save it, and you publish your website. But it goes a bit further than that. This thing is like a rabbit hole. So we have an integrated development environment that we're working on, which we call Artisan. And when Artisan starts up, it looks like, you know, Coder's editor. When it starts up, it also becomes a file system. So then the application itself is a file system. And inside the functions folder, you have functions inside the application that it shows to expose as executables. This is how we're doing our AREX implementation in Friend. We call it dormant, and we're not going to make it a programmer thing. We want everybody to have access to application messaging, so it needs to be a file system. So when you double click the executables, it executes that action in the application. So when you share the application over the net, people using other Friend desktops will be able to execute functions in your client applications running in the JavaScript in your client. This has a lot of implications. It means you can abstract, let's say Photoshop is a tool shed. You can abstract Photoshop, let's say as an example, and you can say, I just want the hammer. Can I mount Photoshop and just execute the hammer in my application to use that cool filter in my application that I don't want to write myself? This means that people can rent out application capability over the internet and share that. This is really clustered application features. You can do a lot of weird stuff with this. So I'm assuming that there's a few developers in the audience. So I'm going to go ahead and I'm going to mount the MySQL virtual file system. So what we do let's see. So when we write code in Friend, we do stuff that is very akin to C coding. So bear with me. I'm going to do this live. So you're going to be able to develop applications directly inside of Brent. And you're going to be able to open the files with our file system abstraction. So you write something like, my file is, and then you use our partitions. You might write home or, you know, tree root or the website you're building, and you can build an application using the different partitions you've connected to your system. You can even write an application using another application as a file system, executing the functions available in that application. So you can actually build an application that opens itself up as a file system. And then you can make functions on a higher level. So you can build a recursive application, basically. Okay. We're also building something we call dormant, do-it. And do-it is basically the next step. So you have got the functions available as executables. So what you can do then is that you can make a playlist. So when you make a playlist, you take the functions that you want, and you put them in Do-It, and then you just play them. So this can be used then a bit like Scala. You can put in JPEG files there, you can put in audio files there, you can put in functions with arguments to them, and you can use basically one of these presentation page up, page down button thingies, and you can control the whole room. You can control the speakers through your functions, you can control the lighting. Suddenly you have a way to program everything in this way, in a really simple, easy to understand way. It's not just for programmers. If this would have been Rx, you could do this in Rx as well. You would have to do programming. But since it isn't programming, it's files, everybody can learn to do this. They can take the application they like, take the function they like, put it in a playlist like an MP3 player, and then they can just play all the functions in batch. So this is really powerful. And you can save that playlist and you can send it to somebody and they can run the playlist. And you can open the playlist and it's actually FriendDOS. It will look a bit like the startup sequence in the Amiga OS. So you can take it that far if you want to, but most people will just drag and drop it into their list. So in Friend, we also have, like you saw, we have screens support, right? And on the furthest, on the backdrop, which was always just a color in the Amiga OS, we're having, you know, buttons and things like that you can click. The idea, this is really early as well. The idea is to have a mini map of your entire system. So if you have connected a mobile phone through the cluster, or it will show you on the deepest field. We call it the deepest field. And all the screens will be collected for each device that has open screens. All the applications running. We want to make some gesture that you can just flick this up and down and then do some work on the deepest field. So this will be a map. It's a perfect place to have it. You know, just look at Android. They have this, you pull down. It's great. You have like two screens in Android. You know. And this is how it works in Friend. That's the control panel. It's basically the deepest field. You see, I have the shell. It works just like Amiga DOS. You can SSH into the Friend form, and you will have an Amiga DOS environment. So that means you can SSH into a Windows computer, and you don't have to use MS-DOS. And you will abstract that system using FriendPort. And then you can install it on Linux, and again, it gets abstracted. So you're not using Bash, or actually you are using Bash, but you don't see Bash. You see FriendOS. This is the point where we come to the realization that the core is communicating through the shell. So when you go into the core, you have a shell, and that's what we build the desktop environment on top of. So that means you can connect to the core through various different means, for example, SSH, and you get up our file system, and you can start interacting with the system that way. And through a WebSocket, we connect the web client to the core, so that when you do stuff on the web client, you can see it in the core. So if you're logged in with a terminal, you can see that you're running Artisan on the client. And you can access the functions of Artisan through the SSH terminal. So this is a dualistic system. The system that's running on the server is a little bit autonomous to the client, which also has a level of autonomy. And they're linked at the hip, and they're doing stuff together. And the client, actually, since it's JavaScript-based, it can run applications from other people's friend instances. So if you have a domain somewhere with friend running, another person who has allowed the origin of that domain can run your applications. And at the same time, you can have a cluster of servers, you can have a cluster of clients. That's why we call this a meta OS. A meta OS is completely reconfigurable in real time, both on the server and on the client. So you can actually upgrade the client applications while it's running, and you can upgrade the servers while it's running. So you don't have to stop anything while you're changing the functionality and the capability of the system. There's nothing to reboot. It's just running. In Friend, you can really create whatever you want. Since it's web-based, it's available everywhere. So if you're at the office and you want to be home, you just open the tab, and you type in your address or IP, and you're home. And it remembers your state. So when the boss comes, you just close the tab. And then you go to a hotel somewhere, you turn on the smart TV, type in the address, you're home again. And this is also a better version. So it's also a system that is going to be completely responsive. So if you view it on a different device, it becomes a mobile application. If you change the screen size, it's a desktop application. I'm going to go into a little bit more. So, as you all know, I'm part of the demo scene. I think for the guys who listened to me yesterday. And in the demo scene, they have something called Shader Toy. This is the new compo that they're starting to have, is that how much can you make out of Shader Toy in 25 minutes, for example. And everybody's in the back, you know, yelling Amiga, you know, because they want to see Amiga-related stuff. So with this, you can actually build something like an Amiga demo, as if it was Shader Toy, you know. So I made a stupid thing in about 10 hours. In 3AS. So I think this is something that could be interesting to the demo scene, to show capabilities that you could submit your thing you can sit with your friend and you can work, and then you can have the demo scene show organizers just just having access to the file system and then just running your presentation for everybody. So everybody's sitting together working in the same environment. Perfect presentation tool. So basically what you can do with this thing is build web applications as if they were desktop applications, view them on the mobile phone, then they become mobile applications, view them on the TV, and then they become smart TV applications. Write the processing logic in C on the server, and you have native speed. Have the server on the same machine as the client, and you have a native environment. Run this with the Node.js version of WebKit as an X session, where you open new windows instead of divs, and then Friend becomes a real desktop environment, intermixing with native applications. This is a thing that can pop up everywhere. It can run on anything, and it will give you the bliss of Amiga style working, programming, and flexibility. And everything else, you can skin this as a Windows environment. You can skin it as, you know, this is to operating systems what WordPress is to content management. You can even use Friendcore as a web server that has an Amiga OS like CPAP, where you can control everything with windows and with buttons and with menus. Also, you can just give a guest account, or you can have an open account, and people can view your domain directly on desktop. You can actually publish your desktop with apps, skin it in CSS, and make a kick-ass website that works special indeed. And it's responsive from the start. The biggest problem we have with our system is that we can't say it's one thing, because it's many different things to different people. It can be a web application transformer that creates web apps out of web applications. It can be an integration tool to create all applications and resources into file systems so that they speak the same language. So you can do an integration once, and all the integrated systems will integrate with all the other systems. It can become a great education tool where people have a sandbox environment to learn coding, and they can't damage anything, and they can go really far in what they can test out. It can be a place to play a lot of web games. It can be a place where you run Windows applications through shared applications through RDP, because our file systems will be available in webdav, and we're also working in Samba, but that takes a bit longer. And then you can open up files from Friendcore directly in Windows. That means that if you share that application through RDP, you can integrate it into your desktop environment and open up the file systems that's on the desktop in Microsoft Word. So you can open up that website in Microsoft Word, write your changes, click Control S, and it's published on the web. And that also means that, you know, once you start doing that, you can do it both ways. So you can start integrating Windows, you know, as a resource for the desktop.
Maybe
we
should open up for questions.
Yeah, I'm gonna come a bit closer. Just sit down, or yeah. How the integration with native applications will work? Photoshop. Yeah, yeah. So basically, somebody said to us, man, you're going to have a lot of integrations on your hand. And so, you know, who's going to make all the integrations? That's, of course, going to be work. It's going to be a great market. Every application has an API. And immediately when you have an API, you can create the integration once. So you have to program the integration. But FriendCore is a program that uses libraries and modules to achieve what it does. So that means it has FriendCore is an application that through runtime linking has various libraries that do different things depending on the requests you get. So if you get a request for a Photoshop file system, the FriendCore will look at its libraries and see if it has the Photoshop module, and the Photoshop module will integrate through the APIs with Photoshop. So we built a system that makes it extremely easy to build these integrations. You can do them prototype in scripting. I mean, we could never have done all this we built a prototype in about 6 months, which was completely insecure, just so that investors know. And we had to script a lot of the things. So we built a system so that you could, in the C program, you could have a C implementation, and where you have blanks, it could fall back to scripting through pipes. So that means you can really fast prototype your integration, and then as you get more time, rewrite it bit by bit in C so that it gets really fast and high performance. And that means you can get really fast to your results. That means you can go really fast to your clients and show them what you can do for them. And once you write it and see it, of course, it becomes fun. Our programming language, how it looks like? You mean like the do it stuff? It basically looks like your startup sequence. It is a sequence of DOS commands with arguments and some ifs and else in there. So it's kind of simple, a bit simple like Amiga DOS was simple. So you run commands and you do stuff with the output. You can check for true or false, but you don't need anything more than that to really do some interesting stuff. Because that's done in the commands, which might be scripts, might be anything, giving an output. So it's really simple to get into, but it has to be. Because you're going to get amateurs writing software again. You know? This is what we want to do. We want to make the average person to participate on the platform. And this is the problem with the demo scene today. The biggest problem with the demo scene today is there comes this young developer, he makes some demo, and it doesn't look like this elite demo. And they're just saying, I did this when I was 12, and this guy just quits the demo scene. And so this actually gives a lower entry level to go in and do some amazing things. It can do something like Amos did for Amiga, for example. It gives you that low entry level to get in, actually even lower, because you can start the programming, you know. This is how we built the staircase. The first staircase is basically just dragging and dropping items to copy stuff. And double-clicking to run applications. The second thing is that you're starting to use the functions in applications through double-clicking. And then the third level is to take those functions and pull them into Doit and run those lists. So that you don't have to double-click that window and double-click that window, you just put them in the list and then it runs both. And then after that, you might open that saved list, which is then like the startup sequence, and start editing it that way. And this is something that every Amiga OS user did at one time. They went into the user stuff. startup and commented stuff out or put in magic workbench or whatever. And then after that, you can start using the dormant through JavaScript and open up those files and execute them in your JavaScript. You go more advanced. And then you might go on finally to see your other things on the server and connect. So we have all the steps from just touching the system to fully interacting with the system.
Yeah, this is my favorite thing from the Amiga, is the assigned role being able to figure out a version of the server and work with the file system.
Anybody who's not familiar with assign? What assign is? Okay, nobody is not familiar, that's great. we're working right now on the assign command. We're talking about this advisory board that we want to have with everybody who's into knowing how an Amiga system looks like. Because we believe that every system that tries to become like the NIPS or the different Unixes are to Unix, we want to have some kind of template for what is an Amiga type OS. And assign is one of those points. Has to be.
Well, yeah, it's pretty cool.
And it also allows you to do some fun things with, you know, you can get all your favorite things together and add them together in one virtual place.
Yeah.
It's just perfect for organizing your files. So this, yes, that's also on the list. Everything that's special about Friend is special because of the file, how it treats files and disks. So, yeah. Any more questions? Yeah, the statefulness. The thing is that the friend doors, and we have a lot of clients that are interested in our project that have no idea what Amiga is. So if we start talking about the science, and, you know, forget it. But what's really big these days is, amongst other things, this Internet of Things stuff, and you know, they're interested in integrating systems and making devices available on the network and all that kind of stuff. So basically what we're doing with the friend course is that we need to be able to replicate, to have redundancy. So what we're doing on the friend course, and which is really interesting to our clients, is that what's happening on one core can be, while it's happening, copied to another core. So if this core goes down, the load balancer will start using the other backup node, which has the same state. Because you cannot only save the desktop state, like the session, like you do, for example, in the K desktop. You also need to save the kernel state, so to speak. And so we're, like I said, a dualistic system. We're doing the same thing on the server as we're doing on the client, and they're working together. So you will have not only the same state on the client, but also on the server. More questions? If any of you guys want to see more at our booth, then or play with it, then, you know, we can do that. Do more experimental stuff that would blow up here. So if nobody has any more questions, then come to our booth instead.